Thanks, Faisal, and everybody else for inviting me. Anne, Mark and I all arrived last night, so we avoided the horror at, well, at least for Anne and I, at Sydney Airport this morning, because the electricity went out. 8,000 people apparently milling round, so I'm grateful I got here last night. Now, I hate to do this to you, but I want you all to stand up again, please. Sorry. Okay, now I want you to sit down when I get to the age at which you are happy to die. Don't sit down now. Yeah. 65. 70. 75. 80. 85. 90. 95. 100. Okay, now that's really interesting. I do this at large groups wherever I go, whether it's medical students or U3A, University of the Third Age, or wherever. I did it last week in the Netherlands, and the average was 90. Which is really interesting. And it was pretty good. It was here, it was 85 or 90. So at 90, one in two of you will have dementia. So I'm just reinforcing Brett's message. It's the one thing we haven't got on top of. And as a geriatrician, it's the one thing that worries me. My mum is 90. She's been expelled from two nursing homes for going over the 1.6 metre fence. She is now somewhere with a 1.8 metre fence and a big paddock so she can walk. And they let her do whatever she wants. So it's wonderful. It's a good warning for my kids, and it's why I'm really interested in dementia. Anyway, that's good. So thank you, Brett, and also Jenny, for her comments. I'm going to talk about a model of care, but before I do that, I want to draw your attention to the clinical practice guidelines, which were developed by the partnership centre that I'm involved with, and a number of people, including Mark, were involved in those. There's a whole lot of them down the front here. What I guess is really important is that underpinning them as Appendix 1 is principles of dignity in care, which are really highlighted. It says clinical practice guidelines and principles of care. And thank you, Louise, wherever she is, yep, for really, really championing those. They should underpin everything we do. As far as we're concerned, these are the gold standard. So that's for us. But for everybody else, we have the Consumer Companion Guide, which is the lay version, if you like, of the guidelines. They are all available, downloadable for free as PDFs. As I said, there's a few here with the chocolates. Don't take the chocolates. You can. But I would really recommend those to you because I think they help. They're what you take to your administrators along with A Better Way to Care, the commission stuff to say this is what we need to do, this is what we should be doing. Okay, so CHOPS, the unfortunately named CHOPS, and again, Louise, I know she's shaking her head. It was an acronym that stuck, unfortunately. This is one of a number of programs that looks at managing cognitive impairment in hospitals. You'll hear from Mark after morning tea about another one, and there are others. But the really good thing is they're all underpinned by the same principles, and they were those very principles that Anne articulated in the previous presentation. Okay, but before I start CHOPS, I want to tell you a story, a true story. This was what we call a SAC2, a severe, it was a reportable incident, severity assessment code 2. And so I've got lots of details. This was from 2009. Mrs. R, 78-year-old lady, lived with a husband in her own home, Northern Sydney. She had early Alzheimer's disease, but she was managing at home with some prompting from her husband. She had a fall in a garden. She was very active. fractured pelvis, and she came into hospital, our hospital, with pain and immobility, obviously, from her fractured pelvis. She was managed with regular analgesia, correct, including opiates, and bed rest. On the following day, she became quite confused. She was aggressive, calling out, wouldn't eat or drink anything. Staff just said, oh, she's got dementia, and left it. She was treated with haloperidol and lorazepam. She was also restrained, but that was because she was very aggressive. She then became drowsy. Well, duh. Her UTI was not recognised. She then developed pneumonia, and she needed IV antibiotics and fluids. She was 3 weeks in an acute hospital ward. I'm sure we've all heard this story before. And she was so deconditioned, she moved to our rehab ward. She couldn't transfer or mobilise when she came to us, and it took 4 weeks before she could get out of a chair or off on and off the toilet, which are the major things to get someone doing. When she did get home, her husband said she was so much worse. So this sort of seven and a half weeks in hospital, she was worse memory-wise, cognitively, but also functionally. She required regular prompting and assistance and a lot of help at home, and actually ended up in residential care not long after. The reason it came to our attention is that her daughter was a lawyer and brought an action against the hospital, which was quite interesting because it helped us in terms of changing practice. There is nothing like a $2 million lawsuit to get people thinking. And what was really interesting, that the tale to the story is that the money that they got, which wasn't a lot, did help pay for her, but the daughter donated a large amount of it anonymously to what then Alzheimer's Australia and several other research foundations. So the money sort of kind, she said, I felt awful doing it, but it changed practice. Mark, do you remember the forum in 2011 where we said, how can we do care better? We need a big stick. And somebody said, change the accreditation standards. It was November 2011, remember? And this is what happened. And you heard what Anne said, and we've been very involved in changing those standards. There wasn't cognitive impairment in the first accreditation standards. There is now. So they are your big stick, guys. You take those standards, and there's five with cognitive impairment in them, I think, and the two in particular. Use those to change practice, because that's what will matter. So just going back to Mrs. R quickly, she came into hospital, she was confined to bed, we did all the wrong things, didn't recognise a delirium, gave her psychotropics when probably she needed a cuddle and reassurance, all those things went wrong, she developed aspiration pneumonia. What we don't look at is the effect on her, her family, after it all, and we have a PhD student actually looking at this, the effect on the person of what we did or didn't do in hospital. She was really sick. She ended up in residential care as a result, really, of what we did. Never got back to a previous level of function. And she was it was a real, what do they call it, pivotal moment for us to really, really look at what we were doing and have the stick that we needed to do a few things. So let me tell you about CHOPS, and I apologise again for the name. But we recognised in 2010, and that incident was one of things, that we didn't do cognitive impairment well in hospitals. From the little MPS, the multi-purpose service, Broken Hill, to big tertiary hospitals. We weren't doing it well. We knew, we're well aware that there's other places, there were good programs, the Hospital Help, Hospital Elder Life Program, DEMDEL, which is a really interesting Swiss program. The problem is it's almost only published in German, so I had to have a colleague tell me what it was. Delirium rooms. There's lots of different things. We knew what we should be doing, but we weren't doing it. We know that if you treat people early, as Anne pointed out, you can prevent 30 to 40% of delirium. You can reduce the falls and all the other horrible things that happen. So we know what we should be doing. So a group of us in New South Wales got together and developed a model of care, and it was a group of clinicians and consumers. And I mentioned consumers again and again, and I was really pleased that you were here talking about it, Brett, because I think we haven't included them enough. And again, Louise, sorry to keep banging sort of at you, but getting people, consumers involved, really made a difference to what we designed for what we said the model of care should be. We piloted just in, we didn't have very much money, in five hospitals, including three country hospitals, came back after a year and said, okay, what did we learn from the pilot? And we developed seven principles of care and an implementation plan, and then we had to get funding, and our partnership centre, which is NHMRC funded, provided funding for the rollout along with our Agency for Clinical Innovation, which is one of the, you know, beautifully named parts of New South Wales Health, but they actually do a great job, very supportive. So we developed that, we rolled it out to 12 hospitals from literally Broken Hill, Bega, right across New South Wales, big hospitals, small hospitals. And we had a steering committee, which Louise, again, was on, and it really hopefully helped drive the rollout. We evaluated it a couple of years ago. I'm going to present a little bit of that data because I think we have to show that, you know, it does work. And we did lots of things, audits, surveys, questionnaires, focus groups, interviews. Everything we did is available on the CHOPS website if you want to look at it. All the audit tools, all that sort of stuff is there, freely available. These are the seven principles of care, and I'm just going to go through them briefly one by one and show you how we did what we did. So the first one, screening. Anne mentioned cognitive screening. Just that routine screening at admission or within 24 hours for cognitive impairment. How many of you know the 4AT? Yeah, I reckon it is the best invention. We couldn't get people to do the other stuff. Do you know the 4AT is you ask the patient, you know, their date of birth, what year it is now, where are they now, and you get them to do the months of the year backwards. Now, I started doing that with our medical students, and I discovered that a lot of medical students can't do the months of the year backwards, or they have to really think about it. And then you ask, are they alert or drowsy, and was this sudden onset or not? That's it. And you can do most of that when you're looking after the patient in the ED. My youngest son is a CNC in ED. He's a registered nurse. And they do it now as part of their OBS. And they weren't doing a lot of the other. They didn't do CAM. And when I asked him why they didn't tell me why they didn't do CAM, he said, oh, Mum, they didn't want to hurt your feelings. They would make up scores. So 4AT, I love it. And you can see pre-CHOPS, we were still doing okay, 40% screening. Post-CHOPS, 68%. So I think we did okay. The second was risk identification and prevention, 19% before, 48% after. So that's looking for those people who are going to develop delirium if they don't have it when they walk in the door. So that Mrs. R was the perfect example. She was on medication that was likely to do it. She was dehydrated because no one was giving her anything to drink. So the other important thing is to do it regularly. The 4AT you can do almost on every shift. We're not quite doing it at every shift, but we're not doing too badly. Whole lot of risk identification solutions up there. And we also have, and I haven't got it here, we have a brochure for carers that we give them. In fact, there's a couple to tell them what we're worried about because often they don't understand initially when you talk about delirium. The third one is assessment. You'd think it was obvious, but it was interesting. A third of people with confusion got assessed in a way you could audit it in the clinical notes before, a bit over half afterwards. So we've still got a way to go here. But we look at a comprehensive assessment. You must have talked to the family member and preferably to the GP or have got some information from the general practice because I think that's hugely important. And shown that there was an appropriate management strategy. So that principle, yeah, we're doing okay, but we've clearly got a long way to go. And this is the CAM, a simple version of the confusion assessment method, which is the screening is the 4AT, but then when you're actually making a diagnosis, you will need something more, more solid, and certainly the confusion assessment method helps. The fourth principle, management. We just wanted to make sure hospitals had in place obvious management programs. Now, if you tick this box, you're obviously going to tick the boxes for the new standards as well, and I think that's important. But you needed to be able to show in the audit we did, and this is what you'll need to show when you are assessed against the standards, that you do identify and treat the cause of delirium. It scared me when we did the audit, the pre-audit, how many people were confused, and people just put pleasantly confused. That's it. And it was always the daughter or someone coming in and saying, she's a lot worse today. And it always seemed to be women for some reason. But it was just, you know, I mean, we now have to have a, we have a formal program that allows, it's called REACH, can't think what it stands for, which makes nurses listen to what families say. Before that, they didn't. We had to have a formal program to allow carers to actually make their concerns felt. That's not in every ward and with every nurse, I should make a point, but, you know, it's unfortunately common. And look, one comment, Anne said we should model the behaviour. I got into real trouble. We had a Greek man who was clearly quite delirious and very upset because his wife had, his daughter had just gone. I went over to him and I gave him a cuddle because that was clearly what he needed. And he settled down pretty quickly and we talked for a while. Then I walked away and a nurse walked up to me, tapped me on the shoulder and said, infection control. So I thought, I said, but I washed my hands before I went to see him. And she said, you put your arms around him. And I thought, oh my God. So it is really interesting. We do have to be careful when we model the behaviour, Anne. But it was, you know, it was just showing the empathy, I think. You know, it's very helpful, isn't it, Brett? I mean, you've had the personal experience, but when you've had a family member with it and you sit there with them and you go through what they're going through, it's a real eye-opener. What is really good on this slide, and this is what makes all our administrators really, really happy, is one of the big side effects of doing the CHOPS program was that we started coding delirium, or the medical records people started coding delirium. That makes a huge difference to your bottom line because you add several thousand dollars to every admission under activity-based funding. If you code delirium, if you put delirium in the notes, the medical records people can code it. Our coding went from 27% for people with delirium, same group of patients, to nearly 80%. We were still missing some, and that was because people were putting acute confusion or acute confusional state, not delirium. So we're getting there. But I think that's one of the, that's the carrot you can use with the medical administrators. The stick is the standards. The carrot is, I mean, apart from just doing things better, the carrot is you can improve your bottom line. I just want to mention a really good program that you can do for free. This was done by one of our colleagues, Kath Bateman, who was also involved in the CHOPS. She developed using volunteers in country hospitals where staffing is not huge. This has been incredibly successful in small hospitals. Again, all the resources are available for free from the Agency for Clinical Innovation website. It's a brilliant way. They're the golden girls or the golden boys. They wear gold T-shirts. And she's now implemented this in a number of country hospitals across New South Wales, and it's just brilliant. I don't see why we shouldn't do it in city hospitals as well, but it is harder in a big hospital. Five, communication processes. Why do we have to write communication into a model of care? One would have thought it was obvious. However, gathering personal life story. When we talk to interns and JRMOs about this, they say, but why do you need to know this? I said, because if you know the name, if you know what they did in the past, and I give you an example, a former Archbishop of Sydney was in our ward, and people were calling him by his first name, or by Mr. sometimes, which was something. He wouldn't do anything. I'd known him for some time, as my father was a member of the Anglican clergy, so I knew who this person was, and I automatically went up to him and said, Your Grace. And he immediately started, you know, he just, oh, and then proceeded to do what we asked him to do. It was as simple as that, and I didn't even realise what I was doing. It was automatic, because I'd known him for 40 years as Your Grace. And I think knowing that life history, was this person a CEO at BHP Billiton? Then they might want to be called Mr. You know, were they a Telstra engineer, where you might call them something else? So I think it's really important, and that communicating with the families and sharing the information. One of the best things is knowing the daughter's name or the wife's name, or most importantly, the dog's name. It is quite amazing when you say, do you miss Pepper? Do you miss, you know, the and people look as if you, what? But they immediately say, I hope someone's taking him for a walk. And, you know, it's almost the first cogent thing they've said for a while. But just, it's those, that relating to the person that's really, really important. Recognising carer needs, we have, and I haven't got a photo, we have the most appallingly coloured lime green carer beds. We made them, we got them lime green so no one would pinch them and so you can see them. They're like business class, good quality business class seats that are chairs, but then they recline to a bed. And they are beside, they're in all our CHOPS wards and in a number of others. So carers can stay all night comfortably. When my dad was dying in our ward, it was pre these chairs, I was in one of those horrible sticky bucket chairs that they have, and I thought, we put patients in this. My back, despite sheets, my back was sticking to it within a sort of 20 minutes. And it made me realise, if you're going to stay all night with someone, you need something comfortable to sleep on. So we've done that. We have somewhere carers can make a cup of coffee or tea. And we try and talk to every, get staff to talk to each other. The sixth is education, obviously. It's what Brett raised. We need to get people understanding. So education plans, look, I've written up here what it is, and this will be available after today. But multimodal, which is the fancy word for written, face-to-face, online. We did all sorts of different ways, but it's raising awareness. We did it at ward level. I would go up between, or at report, at handover, and just talk for 5 to 10 minutes. We did it at hospital level. We took people out and sent them off to delirium days. And training the carers. That has been fascinating and really, really fun, is doing carer education days. Here are just some of the examples. This is Matt Hanrahan, who was CE of Central Coast. His dad had dementia. Do you know Barbara's story? No. Oh, yes. You have to Google Barbara's story. It is the best resource. We got our general manager, who is a hardened finance person, almost in tears watching this. It is developed by St Thomas's at in London, and it is a brilliant resource. It's professionally acted, a story of a lady in hospital. It is just good. The good bit, the bad bit. It is really, really worth using. If you want to get people engaged, use Barbara's story. And I think it's freely available. Definitely worth doing. We have knowledge forums. We get people constantly, hopefully, talking about this. And finally, the environment. And I love this one because this is something we could do practically. Review the environment. We've got a ward audit tool. Simple changes quite often, but if you've got a new build happening, and I'm disappointed to hear it's not particularly dementia friendly here, and you can get an external audit and consultancy, and Anne mentioned that Richard Fleming, who's really into environment, will be doing a webinar for the commission. It's probably worth watching because he's got some great ideas. We looked at layout of ward, access, lighting, signage, all those things, availability of low beds, single rooms, large clocks, calendars, colour contrast, chairs by the beds, pretty obvious things, and access either to lounge areas or to outside. You know what hospitals look like. They're pretty dreadful places. These were just some photos from a couple of different hospitals. They're pretty horrible places to be, even if you're not old. What we looked at was signage. We found all these, and this is in a number of hospitals, not just my hospital, toilet doors with no signs on them. And the nurses said, well, we know where the toilet is. Well, yes, but what if you know, someone from outside the ward, a carer, a patient. So that fascinated us. It was almost, you had no smoking signs, but not toilet or bathroom signs. There were no clocks. You couldn't tell whether it was night or day. The bathrooms are all white, or that horrible yellow that they used to be. Minimal light, night lighting, and certainly the cluttered corridors. It was fascinating when you actually go in with an audit tool, and the audit tool is there, and there's actually the principles. On the left here is the principles for improving environments. That's all available on the website. So what did we do? We got clocks. We got calendars. We put black seats on the toilet instead of white seats on the toilet. The only coloured thing in the toilets was the red call button. And so people, when they flushed the toilet, would press the red call button because they couldn't see the flush. And this would happen not just with patients, but with family members as well. We put signs on the door. We actually got Rotary locally. They wanted to do something. So we said, well, will you pay for shower and toilet signs? So we did that. We got the nurses to have big name tags so that you people knew who was coming to them. And just on the bottom right here, when we did our delirium and dementia unit at Hornsby, we actually painted the walls different colours and the doors. So people, it's funny, they knew that they were in the blue spotted door. It was just really interesting. We had other colours as well, but it was fun doing that. Can you sustain CHOPS? Well, that worried us because we did have funding to roll it out. It's finished well and truly now. Everything that's happening now is done without funding. But we know you link it to the accreditation standards, you link it to the delirium care standard that Anne presented. You do need support from Hospital Gizek, and that's how coding is really important because you can show them there's money. We certainly still support forums. If people ring, we talk to them on the phone. And everything, as I said, is on the website. The other thing is we're really into falls in New South Wales. Apparently, New South Wales has the worst falls rate in hospitals. So we've been able to link. We're actually looking at delirium as a major cause of falls, which we know it is. So we're using that as well. Have we gone beyond New South Wales? And this, I think, is what we're really happy about. Royal Brisbane and Women's have taken it up in two of their hospitals. And not only did they take the seven principles, they added one on discharge planning. And I reckon imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. And adding something to it was really, really good. Monash Health in Melbourne are using it to underpin their development. We know that CHOPS, the principles, are part of a very large grant in southern Germany where they're implementing better care for people with cognitive impairment in surgical and orthopaedic wards. And they translated them into German, and they look quite interesting in German. But as I said, there's the website again. I've given you lots of those. This is what Brisbane did, just out of interest. They took the principles, and you can see the red circle. They added discharge planning. I don't know why we didn't think of discharge planning. Obviously, it didn't occur to us when we were developing the principles. So I think that's great, and that should definitely be in there in future. And I'm just going to finish with Mrs. another story, and this was from about 3 months ago. So very similar lady to Mrs. R, a couple of years older. Mrs. D, 81-year-old lady, mild dementia, lives with her husband. Fell over in the shopping centre, common story, and came to the ward through ED, given regular paracetamol and non-steroidals, something we used to do, and a couple of times low-dose opiates. So her pain was treated. She was screened for delirium on admission. She was noted to have short-term memory problems, but not delirium. She had cognitive impairment, but not delirium. She was nursed out of bed. She was stood in a forearm support frame, as you can see there. Apologies, it's not a wonderful photo. She was encouraged to drink fluids regularly. The family were there as much as possible and stayed by her bed. She was in a four-bed ward, So it wasn't ideal, but there was room for her family. There was space. We had a clock. As I said, a family could be there. She was screened daily, sometimes twice for delirium. She became agitated and aggressive about day three. The UTI was immediately recognised, treated. Family were there to provide support. We didn't need to use psychotropic medication. She moved to rehab after 6 days, not 3 weeks. Did really well. She went home after 3 weeks with home-based rehab, who transitioned her from the frame to a cane to nothing. There was no significant worsening of cognitive impairment or function, according to her husband and daughter. She still didn't walk as well as she used to, but other than that, and I reviewed her in my clinic, she was pretty good. She doesn't actually remember most of the admission, which is probably a good thing. So on that, I'd like to finish. This is the bus stop we have in our hospital. I had to actually remove the two patients from the seat to take the photo simply because I didn't have their permission to take the photo. So, but that's just as you can see, between 2 4-bed wards. And it is amazingly used. You know, I thought, oh, come on. But let me tell you, it was great. And with that, on time, hopefully, thank you.